Academy.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
What are your first impressions?
It's very formal.
We don't need it to be. What are your first impressions here?
Actually, I'll tell you, my first impression is just how incredibly well equipped this place is. But I mean, compared to the school I went to and the resources, I mean, this is just like sort of, ten times.
I must say the glass makes it feel like a sci-fi film.
Well, but also the kind of attention you're getting. I don't know if this is right, but I've just been on a tour and I think Sophie was saying that every student gets a one-on-one tutorial once a week.
Yeah. We've got like the personal like touch for our school now. Everything's more personal, the students and everything.
Well, I mean, if you don't know this already, I mean, that is amazing to get that kind of attention. Yeah. I went from term to term. The only time I would have had a one-to-one with my teachers would be if I'd done something wrong.
Whereas what it would have been like at primary school, I must say.
Yeah. Whereas you're getting it if you've done something right. I mean, as I understand it, you sit down and look at your targets that you join.
Yeah, for setting goals and looking at things you're struggling with and how you can improve on them and all that kind of thing.
Yeah, so my overriding impression is that you're incredibly lucky to be at this school.
Yeah, it is a privilege, actually.
Yeah, it does feel so much better. So, Sam and I are very interested in acting and the performing industry. And I found out that you're on the board for the Royal Shakespeare Company.
Yeah.
So, how did you get there and what's it like?
Well, I'm I think I'm a trustee.
Oh, okay.
I think, my board, I don't know, anyway. I'm on the RSC, and I think not because I know anything about acting. Mm. I think I'm there to help with other things. And one of the things that I'm really got involved with the RSC is with their education campaign.
Yeah.
Because my sense of it is, and the Royal Shakespeare Company feels, that too often Shakespeare is kind of taught in, let's do
sort
this.
Sort of alienated.
And you're kind of doing the page turn stuff. Mm. And they have this campaign, Stand Up for Shakespeare. You know, you do it standing up.
Oh, I see. Like, more practical.
Yeah, that's what it was meant to be when Shakespeare was writing. He was writing it for a GCSE.
Yeah, no, exactly.
And also to bring Shakespeare into schools. Mm. You know, certainly in the kind of private sector, everybody's sort of comfortable with Shakespeare and so on. Mm. But there was a sense that in state schools, even some of the teachers felt, you know, not entirely comfortable teaching it.
I can understand that.
So that's what I do for the RSC, help them with their education campaign mainly. Hmm. And the end, as I say, nothing to do with performance. Although there's an element to what I do as a television presenter,
Of course.
Where there's an element of performance. Up to 6 o'clock. Everything I do is journalism. Mm. After 6 o'clock, when the camera starts rolling, I would say there's kind of 50% performance.
It's just about delivering it, isn't it? And I guess that helps all sorts of diction and things. Do you think recent scandals at the BBC are undermining the corporation's brand and its reputation as a reliable source of information?
Yeah, and by scandals, I'm interested in talking about the whole Jimmy Savile. Crisis, and it is a crisis. Mm. It has been
Definitely,
a crisis.
Yeah.
There's no question that what happened over the way in which the Jimmy Savile business was handled, and the fact that it occurred sometimes allegedly on kind of BBC premises. And
yeah.
So on. There's no question that it did have an effect on the BBC. In as far as we can judge, actually, people are beginning again to understand what went on, you know, the mistakes, the ignorance, and so on, that happened. So while it did affect the BBC and people's perception of the BBC, my sense of it is that actually it's nothing that we can't regain.
Exactly. They're already looking ahead and
moving forward.
Because if the BBC stands for anything, if the BBC is known around the world, not just in this country. It's known for its news, its impartial news, and that's all about trust and authority.
Yeah,
and we still do that. You know, our standards are still the same. In fact, through the whole of this Jimmy Savile scandal, BBC News reported sometimes on our own colleagues
and discern
a completely impartial way.
Yeah.
And I think that tells you something about the BBC.
Mm. The fact that they were right in the middle of it, but they could still keep an unbiased perspective.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, exactly. It's a part of our DNA. So it's had an effect, but I don't think it's a permanent one.
Earlier you said that you had an interview with Nelson Mandela. Do you have a favourite interview? Was it that interview?
Well, do you know, I don't think it is. I mean, it's probably the most kind of memorable interview I've had was with Nelson Mandela. But he's a hard interview because once you go beyond the kind of news interview, which is just looking for a 15-second clip or something to put into a news report, and anything longer than that, the kind of thing you and I are doing, we're doing now, it's really about getting under the skin of someone.
Yeah.
And Nelson Mandela was incredibly hard to sort of unpeel and unpack. Mm. He would not go personal. And I've often wondered what it is about him, whether actually some of what he had to endure was simply so horrid that he didn't want to dwell on it and so on. So in that sense, I think I didn't get a particularly revealing interview in personal terms from him. I think that the interviews that I've perhaps enjoyed most, and I think were both fun to do and revealing, were with that other South African, which is Archbishop Desmond Tutu, who's an amazing character. He has this lovely impish humour, and he can do moral authority on the one hand, and he can do cheeky chatting on the other hand. That's an effort skill. There's very few people who can pull it off, and he definitely can. So I think in some ways those are the interviews that kind of stand out. The other one, and it's a bit trite to say this, but actually it's all the people who weren't famous. You know, I've been welcomed into people's homes in kind of the worst of times and the most desolate of times, and they invited me into their homes with an open heart and a warm hand and reveal something of themselves, talk to me about their lives, which actually sometimes takes courage, and sometimes it literally took courage because it was sometimes pointing the finger at injustice. Knowing that somebody might then say, hey, why did you go and talk to
them? Yeah, and that kind of experience must be the kind of experience that affects you more personally. Because interviewing famous people is good, I suppose, for the public.
Yeah.
But
I think, so some of those unnamed people, if I can put it that way, have been some of the great interviews.
What level of global perspective do you think you've gained by being one of the BBC's leading foreign correspondents?
I think two things. I didn't come to it, if you like, as a kind of blank sheet of paper. I came to international reporting as a foreign correspondent with my own history.
Yeah, from your experience.
You know, with one foot in the poor world and one foot in the rich world.
Yeah.
So I think I learned a lot travelling around the world, whether it was the Rwandan genocide or 9/11 in New York or an earthquake in Andhra Pradesh or the tsunami in Japan. I've learned a lot, but I think my reaction to what I've seen has been fashioned by who I am, my own personal journey. So when I went to Africa as a reporter, it was never for me the kind of the dark continent, the strange continent, the continent where you know there's a lot of evil and so on. To me, sometimes it felt like home because I think, I hope anyway, that I've brought a different perspective to my reporting on Africa, and a perspective that said, actually, they're going through some terrible times, but at the heart of it, there are those people.
Yeah, it's not just scripted as well, because you know exactly what you're talking about.
And you know, people sort of talk about the human spirit, and well, I think I've not just seen it, I've not just heard it, I think I've actually touched it. I've touched it in Africa.
Yeah.
Because actually, it's there in the worst of all times, when people have lost everything, when they're stripped bare of this thing that you call civilization, say it's in the middle of a genocide or a natural disaster, then all you have actually is the human.
Yeah.
And you understand how powerful we are,
yeah,
even when we're stripped bare.
It's resilient.
And that's I think that's been a real privilege. It's been the lesson that I've taken away from 20 years as a foreign correspondent, is that you know, greatness, actually you find it sometimes in the most humble places. Yeah. In fact, quite often you don't find it in the president's office.
Or the minister's
office. Quite often find it in some little hut or dwelling somewhere.
You've had a very successful career and you've achieved a great deal. Have you got any plans for what you would like to do next? I mean, what's next for George Alagiah?
Well, I mean, I'll tell you what, I think that I still get a huge buzz out of doing the news.
Yeah.
There's a part of me that likes that whole adrenaline moment.
Mm.
But I am beginning to feel that I want to do something kind of maybe more creative.
You mentioned the documentaries and the library.
Yeah.
Yeah, talking about that.
So that's creative, that's long form, but also actually maybe try my hand at kind of fiction. I mean, just make it up.
Yeah, that makes sense.
So I'd quite like to think about writing a novel, maybe.
Mm-hmm.
I'd like to quite like doing what I'm doing today,
yeah,
which is use some of my experience to get out and do something different.
Which is very inspirational to us.
Yeah,
obviously.
Well,
that's
the whole.
I hope so. Well, thank you. So yeah, I think if there was one word that kind of summed up where I want my career to go, is creativity.
Mm.
I think to explore that side of it, not to be governed entirely by the deadline.
Yeah,
which is what
you've got a lot of support and recognition, which you have doing at the moment, so people will follow you if you do decide
Hopefully.
To take a
Hopefully.
Are you okay for time? Are you on a schedule?
I think I'm going to have to.
Okay.
Oh, well,
it was very nice.
It's a huge pleasure.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Where's this going to go on the website?